We have heard and seen some very powerful sermons and presentations from up here, haven't we?
Yes.
Amen. I hope and pray that when everyone goes home, they don't go home as the same individual that they came as. I pray that everyone takes that which they have learned and they go home and apply it in their life. With that, I would like to start with a word of prayer, and I would like to petition each and every one of you that you not only pray for the sermon and the presentation, but that you pray for me and you. So let's bow or kneel where possible. Heavenly Father, we come before you on this sacred day requesting, petitioning that you will be here with us. Father, I pray that you will speak through me, that you will anoint my lips with a coal from off your altar, that you will hide me behind Christ, and that I will speak your words, and that I will present your body language and your tone of voice. Father, I pray that you will anoint the eyes and the ears of those watching and listening, that they may hear your message, and that it will not just be head knowledge, but that it will touch the hearts. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We've been looking at the final atonement. And we've been looking at the importance of understanding this final atonement. I want to start by looking at Hebrews chapter 11, starting in verse 33. Hebrews chapter 11, starting in verse 33, and here in Hebrews chapter 11, what is this chapter known as?
The faith chapter.
The faith chapter. So this talks about mighty men of old, like Abraham, right? Men like Moses. And in fact, it tells us what righteousness by faith is when it talks about Moses, which we're not going to touch on, but that's very interesting. Starting in verse 33, it's just got done talking about these mighty men of valor, these mighty men of faith. And in verse 33 it says, "Who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions. They quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned the flight to the armies of the aliens." Verse 35, "Women received their dead, raised to life again. And others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskin and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth." Does that sound familiar to final prophetic events for us?
Very much.
Verse 39, "And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise." So here, these men of old, these men of faith, they did all these mighty works, but they did not receive the promise. Verse 40, "God having provided some better thing for us, that they, without us, should not be made perfect." Is there a difference between the time that Abraham lived and the time that we live?
Yes, just a little bit.
Just a little bit. We are living in the final atonement. Was Abraham living in the final atonement?
No.
No. But we are. We are called to a higher standard. Abraham was called to the standard, but God is now going to provide us the ability to get there. Amen?
Amen.
Revelation chapter 22, verse 11 and 12. Many of you can quote verse 11 probably right off the top of your head, and hopefully so. This is a very important verse in the understanding of the Advent, in our understanding of the final atonement. Revelation 22:11 says, "He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still." Verse 12, "And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his works shall be." So I have a question. Verse 11, in chronological timeline of events, does verse 11 come before or after verse 12?
Before.
So there is the statement of being holy. There is a time coming where we will have to stand before God without an intercessor. But you know, a lot of people look at that theology and they try to shred it up and they try to tear it up and they try to throw it out, because they will say, Jesus said he will never leave me nor forsake me. But you know what? They're right. Jesus will never leave you nor forsake you. But you know what? If Jesus is doing his job, and you think he's doing his job?
Yes.
He will empower a people that will be able to stand before God without that intercessor. So let's look at it from this perspective. We put Jesus out of a job. Think about that. We no longer need him to be an intercessor. We are able to stand before God without the intercessor, with no guile in our mouths. That is the point of the 144,000. Was Abraham a part of the 144,000?
No.
But we can be. Because we are going to stand before a holy God. Revelation 21, verses 1 to 8. This gives us a written view. It paints a picture of heaven. Revelation chapter 21, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. There was no more sea, and I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them." I want you to remember that phrase. He will dwell with us. "He will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying. Neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of water of life freely." Do you want to drink of that fountain of water of life freely? We've just seen a written picture, a painting of heaven. And it's not something we can truly grasp. But it is there. And it is real. So the question, who will be within the gates? Verse 7. "He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and they shall be my son." So who is it that is within the gates? Those that overcome, right? Verse 8 now tells us who it will be that will be outside those gates. "But the fearful, the unbelieving, and the abominable, murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars," not just white liars, all liars, not just big liars, all liars, "shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." Let's look briefly at Revelation 22:14 now. So we've seen two groups. The group that is within the gates and the group that is without the gates. Let's look at more detail now on that group that is within the gates. Revelation 22:14. Blessed are they that do His commandments. That do what? That do His commandments. That they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. So those that are inside the gates are those that do the commandments. They are those that keep the commandments. Does that make sense? You see that clearly? So that means that those that are without the gates are those that do not do the commandments, those that do not keep the commandments or break the commandments. Does that make sense? Clear, logical sense? So I want to look and I want to analyze ourselves. Are we going to be outside those gates? And the picture that's going to be painted is not a pretty one. So those that are outside the gates are obviously commandment breakers. Commandment breaker is a law breaker. Does that make sense? What is a commandment or law breaker? 1 John 3:4. Sin is the transgression of the law. Transgression means literally to step over, to break the law. So if we were to say sin is the breaking of the law, what is the breaking of the law then?
Sin.
Sin, right? So those that are outside of the gate are those that have broken the law. Those that are outside of the gate are sinners. Can you see that clearly?
Yes.
Romans 3:20. By the law is the knowledge of sin. So the law gives us an understanding of what sin is. In other words, the law gives us a definition of sin. Romans 4:15, where no law is, there is no transgression. There is no breaking of the law if there is no law. So those that are outside of the gates are those that have broken the law. Romans 7:7, I had not known sin but by the law, for I had not known lust except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. Now I realize for most of us, this is a basic understanding. This is a basic Bible study. Most of us probably know these verses right off the top of our head. But I hope and pray that when this is all said and done, that you will have a new light to look at sin. So clearly, those that are outside the gate are sinners. Have you seen that so far? The next question, am I a sinner? Because I don't want to be outside that gate. Am I a sinner? Romans 3:10, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:23, for all except for me have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Is that what it says? All have sinned. That includes me. That is an all-inclusive statement. Picture's getting pretty bleak, isn't it? I don't want to be out there. I want to be inside those gates. But so far what I've seen is I'm outside those gates. What is the result of sin? Death. Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is
death.
Are you sure it's not eternal torment? The wages of sin is death, is to cease to exist. Ezekiel 18:20, the soul that sinneth, it shall
die.
And just so that we have this crystal clear, Exodus 32:33, and the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever has sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. What book is this? The book of life. So this is not talking about an earthly death, those verses that we just read. This is talking about an eternal death, a death that there is no resurrection from.
Amen.
For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Why can't I go to heaven being a sinner? Because so far, We've seen that we all want to be in those gates, but everything so far is telling us clearly we're outside of those gates. So why can't I go to heaven being a sinner? And Pastor Allen kind of touched on this. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither his ear heavy that it cannot hear. Again, I want to stop there. The picture that we've seen so far is pretty bleak. We need to take this verse and we need to cling to it tenaciously. Amen. Because the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, and his ear is not heavy that it cannot hear. He does hear our pleas, amen, and he can save.
Amen.
So we need to take this verse and we need to cling to it tenaciously with every ounce of faith we've got. Verse 2, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear. What has separated us from God?
Sin.
Our iniquities, right? They have separated us. Verse 3, for your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies, even teensy, weensy, white lies. Even one is enough to separate us. Your tongue hath muttered perverseness. Now there's a lot in that last statement, muttering perverseness. I could spend a whole hour just talking about that alone. It is so easy, without thinking about it, to mutter something perverted. But that alone separates us from God. So why? Why does sin separate us from God? Did you know it's for our benefit that he did that? That sin separates? Because he is a gracious God. That is why he separated us. He is separated from us because of our sin. Deuteronomy 4:24, for the Lord thy God is a consuming fire, even a jealous God.
Amen.
He is a consuming fire. You know, we will all be on fire. One way or another, we will all be on fire. Either for God or before him. We are either going to be on fire for God now, or we're going to be standing before him outside the gates on fire.
Amen.
One way or another, because God is a consuming fire.
That's right.
If we're going to come into his presence and survive it, we must have had everything burned off prior.
Amen.
We must be on fire.
Amen.
When we come into his presence.
Amen.
You see, God has said that he will make an end to sin. And he is, in his grace, has warned us that sin will be destroyed. And it is our job, brothers and sisters, to warn everyone else that sin will be destroyed. And see, if we clutch that sin, if we hang on to that sin, God has warned us that we will be destroyed with that sin.
That's right.
We need to let go of that sin and open our hands and say, Lord Jesus, take it.
Amen.
I don't want it. I do want it, but I don't want it. It's kind of like a firecracker. Take a nice sized firecracker and clutch it in your hands, and the tighter you squeeze, when that fuse is lit, the more damage it does, right? So as you squeeze tighter and tighter and tighter, the more it's going to take your fingers off when it goes off. Even a small firecracker can take fingers off when you clutch it tight enough. But if you take that same firecracker and you hold your hand out, when it goes off, it's going to hurt, but it's not going to take your fingers with it.
Amen.
And so we need to do the same thing with sin. Instead of, if we clutch that sin, the tighter we clutch it, the more damage it's going to do. and we will be destroyed with it. But if we take that sin and we hold it out because the final atonement has lit the fuse, we need to quickly, time is running short, we need to quickly open our hands and release it. And when it goes off, it's going to hurt, but we will be saved. How many think that letting go of sin doesn't hurt? It does hurt, doesn't it? It's not the easiest thing to do. And sometimes when you release... Now, sometimes some people are blessed when they release sin. There's no pain involved. But that's only by God's grace, because the natural result is going to be pain, even when you release it. But, you know, I'm generally a good person. Have you ever heard that? Have you ever thought that? Absolutely. I had a walk of justification. Lord, I'm generally a good person. That was my justification. When I was in steel construction, you know, I would look about at those guys around me, as a foreman and COO, I would look about at these guys and I would say, you know, I don't do as many drugs as they do. You know, I don't drink as much as they do. You know, I would only have one or two. These guys, boy, they'll go home and they'll have a 24-pack at a night. Wow, I couldn't even stand the next day if I did that. You know, I'm not as bad as they are. I don't swear quite as much as they do. You know, I'm generally a good person. You know, God knows my heart. He does know our heart, doesn't He? Jeremiah 17 says so. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Brothers and sisters, if we're not careful, we will allow our heart to deceive us into thinking that it's good when it's not. It is deceitful above all things, and it is desperately wicked. Now I have a question. Would you say Moses was generally a pretty good person? Yeah. You know what? I read through the Exodus, and I read through these examples, and I turn red in the face. Just, I want to strangle these stiff-necked people. I don't know how Moses took it. That man was not just generally a good person. He was all but a saint in my eyes. I could never have dealt with that. But you know what? I want to just make a little side note. I see the same thing in the Advent movement. We are a stiff-necked people. We are a stiff-necked people. We are Laodicea.
Amen.
But Moses, you know, I read these examples of Moses, and you know, the people would come to him and they would, "You've done this. You've done that. You've brought us into this wilderness to die." Really? He was following the cloud. How could they blame it on him? They justified it, right? It's pretty hard to blame God, but it's pretty easy to blame Moses. It's easy to justify. The heart is deceitful, and it is desperately wicked. But you know what? I read those examples of Moses, and I think, wow, this was a man of patience, a man of meekness. You know, Moses only struck that rock instead of speaking to it. Out of all that, he put up with all of that, that stiff-necked people constantly coming to him and pointing their fingers at him, and he never got angry. Well, I would have been angry right off the bat. Oh, you blaming me? I'm just following the cloud. You can't blame me. But Moses made a mistake. And you stop and think about it. And that's kind of a simple little mistake. He just simply struck the rock instead of speaking to it. But that kept him out of Canaan. that one little thing. I want you to think about something else. We look around us today and we see sorrow, we see suffering, we see pain, we see death. Many of us have lost loved ones or friends to car accidents or cancer. Many of us have struggled with cancer. Many of us have struggled with these things. You know what started all of this? Think about it. Adam only ate a fruit. Adam didn't eat a pig. Adam didn't eat a cow. Adam didn't even eat a donut. Adam ate a fruit, a raw, vegan, in its natural state, fruit. And what did that start? Sin. What do we have about us? Sin, death, sorrow. And it all started with eating a raw, vegan fruit. We're in hillbilly country, or as I should say, politically correct, Appalachian American country. Appalachian. So let's say somebody came through that door carrying a sack, a paper, or not a paper, but like a burlap sack.
A poke.
Okay. Thank you. Carrying a poke. And in it was obviously something. And he comes in, and right about the middle of the room, he grabs the bottom of that sack and he tips it up. He releases the end of it and he runs to save his life to get for that door. And out comes an 8-foot timber rattler. What would everyone do here?
Run,
right? There would be mass chaos. In fact, I would venture to guess that more people would be hurt in the panic for the door than would be hurt by the snake. And those of you over here, I'm sorry, but you're just going to have to climb the walls because your snake's between you and that door. Now, if you think about that, we would flee from that snake like our life depended upon it, wouldn't we? But you know what? Sin is more dangerous. One little sin is infinitely more dangerous than that poisonous serpent.
Amen.
Because that poisonous serpent can bite and we might die from it. We'll definitely suffer, but we might die from it, but it will only be an earthly death. But the injection of venomous sin will kill us eternally. It will destroy us where there's no return. You know, we think about that snake and, oh yeah, oh. But we think about sin and we want to go up to it and we want to pet it and we want to love on it and we want to handle it. And we want to say, oh, don't you want my friend? You can pet him. I promise he won't hurt. He won't bite. And if he does, he won't kill you. You know, so it's okay. You want to pet him? That's what we do. That's how we treat sin. We run from the snake, but we want to play with sin. We're in the final atonement. There is no time to play with sin. Hebrews 9:26, he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. 1 Peter 2:24 says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree. Now I want to give you a visual example. Brother DeMario, where are you? Would you bring Shemaiah up? We've all seen Shemaiah walking around and in his innocence, and you know, he takes his toy and he'll walk up to you and hold it up with a big smile on his face, right? Let's see if I can give this example without getting emotional, because my mind, my body, my spirit, it shrinks from this thought. Okay, I gotta stop looking at my wife. Now let's say Shemaiah, in his innocence, it's your job to protect him, right? Mm-hmm. Primarily, or is it, if someone were to try to hurt him, they would have to go through you, right?
Yes.
Now, let's say that someone's sin. Now, I want you to think about this. How many of you, I'm going to see if you're awake, how many of you are the child of someone by raising your hand? Okay, everybody's awake. Now, how many of you have children or a child? Okay, now I want you to think about this question seriously. And even if you don't have children, you can still get it. Think about this question. Now, DeMario, if someone's sin, I'm not talking about your sin, or I'm talking about someone else's sin. Let's say my sin. Let's say I sinned. Just a tiny little white lie. And it took Shemaiah and it whipped him with a cat of nine tails. And it put a crown of thorns on his head. And then it nailed him to the cross. At this age, in his innocence, could you come to me and say, you know, brother, that's okay. You just keep on sinning. Could you do that?
No.
No. There is not a word in this English language that would be able to express your hatred, your abhorrence of sin, is there?
No, that's the word that comes to my mind. I would abhor. I mean, that's the only word that I can think of. Greatly abhor it, even more. And in fact, it makes me think of those who lose their children to, like, cancer. They go on campaigns against cancer. You know, it would be that extreme, I think.
Amen. Thank you. Right. I want each and every one of you to think about that. What would you think about sin if it did that to your child? In your child, in their innocence, it were to, my sin, just a tiny little sin. Maybe I ate a raw vegan fruit that I was told not to eat. And that simple little sin took your child in his innocence and whipped him with a cat of nine tails, placed a crown of thorns upon his head and put him on that cross. You would have a whole new understanding of sin, wouldn't you? You would hate sin. You would abhor sin. There is not a word in the English language that could begin to describe how much you hated it. Brothers and sisters, those people that say, oh, it's okay, you just keep on sinning, they have not seen sin in the light of the cross. They have not seen it. If you see that cross, if you truly experience that cross, you will never, ever be able to say that. Never. We will never see sin aright until we see it in the light of the cross. Amen?
Amen.
Wait a minute, though. Are you saying, are you preaching perfection?
Yes.
Amen. Absolutely. And I'm proud of it. I am preaching perfection. I am. Will I ever be perfect on this earth?
Have to be.
What's that?
Have to be.
Now, I want to ask a question. Now, this hill mountain out here, I'm in the south. Do y'all call that a hill or a mountain?
Hill.
Okay. Let's pretend that it's a mountain, okay? And let's say that God told you to go out there and put your shoulder into that mountain, give it a push, and move it. Can you do it?
Nope.
I hear yes and no, and the answer is, you're both right.
Yeah.
I can't do it. But who can? So if he told me to do it, is it possible?
Yes.
It is possible. So, but. That's what the goats do, isn't it? But. You know, that's what we want to do. We want to, but God, I can't do that. There's no way. I can't do it. Or we want to say, oh, but God, you know, I can't do it. I saw Abraham try. He couldn't do it. And he was a man of faith. He landed in the Hebrews 11, the faith chapter. He couldn't do it. I know I can't do it. That's what we tend to do, isn't it? Or we'll walk up to that mountain and sorry, it's not going to happen. Isn't that what we do?
Yes.
So this is what I say to people when they ask, can I be perfect on earth? I say, that's not for you to decide. Mm-hmm. Now, if I were to walk up to that mountain, God told me to go over there and put my shoulder into it and push it, and it would be thrown into the sea. And I walk over there, and I put my shoulder into it, and I push with all I've got, and it's picked up and it's cast into the sea. Now, could I come back up here and go, look at me! Look at what I did!
No way.
Of course not. That would be total ignorance. There is no one that would ever say that I did that. Everyone would have to attribute it to who?
God.
We have to do the same thing with sin. He's told us, be therefore perfect, even as my Father in heaven is perfect. We have been told to walk as Jesus walked. Now, does that mean that I have to go to Jerusalem and oh, there's a footprint. Oh, there's another footprint. Is that what that means? No. Does that mean that I have to figure out what kind of gait he had? Maybe he had pigeon toes, slightly pigeon-toed, so I need to walk that way? Does that mean that maybe he had a particular saunter and I need to walk that way? No. That's not what that means at all. We are told to walk as he walked. Oh, but he was divine. You can't use that against me. I'm not. But you know what? He has promised to give us that overcoming life, hasn't he? So if I walk out to that mountain and I give it a shove, for all I've got and it moves, I can't claim that victory for mine. Because it is impossible for me to do that.
Right.
Just like sin. It is impossible for me to overcome that sin. So can I be perfect on this earth? The answer is no. But God told me to do it. So if I put my shoulder into it, not if. Did I say if?
Mm-hmm.
When? When I put my shoulder into it and I push with all my might, it moves. It happens. God did it.
Amen.
It is not for us to worry about whether I can be perfect or not. Because I can't do it anyways. It's not for me to worry about. It's for me to put my shoulder into that mountain of sin and push. And not question. Just do it. Exodus chapter 24, 15 to 17. Exodus chapter 24, starting in verse 15. And Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount. And the glory of the Lord abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And the sight of the glory of the Lord was like a, what, fire? A devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the eyes of the children of Israel. Now we've heard Brother Allen telling us about how Moses went to the first level with the 70 elders, and then he went to the second level with Joshua. What did he do there at that second level for 6 days?
Prepare.
He prepared. And I suggest to you that the only way we're going to come into the presence of God is to follow this example. That we must come into His presence before we can come into His presence physically, we must first come into His presence spiritually.
Amen.
We must contemplate His glory, purity, and mercy until we can approach nearer to Him. This is the answer to the sin problem that I've got in my life. See, the closer I come to Him, the hotter that fire gets. And as I come closer and closer, more and more of the sin is burned off.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
He is a devouring fire, and I must come into His presence and have that sin burned off. And by His grace, when sin entered this world, we became separated so that we were not destroyed instantly.
Amen.
But we need to enter back into His presence, step at a time, burning off the dross of sin.
Amen.
Because Nahum 1:9 tells us, He will make an utter end. Affliction shall not rise up the second time.
Amen.
And the only way that can happen is if we come into His presence, step at a time, and become on fire now, before we are on fire outside those gates. We must become on fire. Now I'm going to ask Brother Bruce if he will sing a song on page 51 of your hymnal, I Surrender All. Now, what I would like is for each and every one to sing audibly, but kind of hushed a little bit, softly. And I want you to, as you sing this, I want you to pray it. I Surrender All. Page 51. want to give a quick testimony. I went to Amazing Facts Center of Evangelism some years ago, and prior to that time, in my previous life, I gave kind of a little bit of an example of my previous life, and it wasn't pretty. I had a tobacco problem, and you know what, I was at an AFCO. The room was about this size. There were 32 people in there, and we had just been dismissed, and I was on one side of the room. I was kind of in a, you know, in the back corner. We had just been dismissed. Everybody had stood up, and you know how it is when you get a bunch of people standing and just been dismissed. There's a lot of talking and a lot of loud noise, and if anyone knows me, they know when it comes to lots of background noise, I can't hear anything. If you've seen me in the noise, and there's a bunch of noise around, you'll notice I'm looking at your lips. That's because I can't distinguish what you're saying out of the crowd. But this had happened, everyone had stood up and everyone was talking, and all of a sudden, I had an urge for tobacco like I've never had in my life. This urge was so strong that if there was a can on the table, I wouldn't have cared what anyone thought had I grabbed it and put some in. That's how strong this was. And I knew instantly this was supernatural. And I just silently prayed. I said, Lord, you've got to help me. And before I could even finish that prayer, through the crowd on the opposite side of the room, I heard someone singing under their voice, I surrender all. Very low toned. I surrender all. Just like that, in a crowded room, I heard it clear as day. And I immediately looked and I could see him singing over there. I knew it wasn't my imagination. I could see him through the crowd singing, and I could hear it as though we were in a silent room and he was standing beside me. And I took that song and I started singing it. Instantly, that craving was gone. Just like that. You know, if we come to that mountain of sin and we put our shoulder into it, and by faith we push, it will be picked up and cast into the sea. So I have a question for you. Will you, by faith, put your shoulder into the mountain of sin and push? Show of hands. Who's willing to do that? Amen. Put your shoulder into that mountain of sin and push. And leave the results to God. Don't worry about whether it's going to go somewhere. You can't make it go somewhere. God can.
Amen.
Don't worry about it. You just push.
Amen.
Let's take that decision and let's go to the Lord in prayer, because He is the one that will make it move.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come before you now humbly on your great Sabbath day, Father, praying that you will take this sin from us. Father, each and every one of us has something that we're thinking about even right now that we know is something in our life that we need to get rid of. Father, we've learned that we can't get rid of it on our own. But you've told us to get rid of it. And so, Father, we by faith have committed to put our shoulders into that sin and push. And we expect, we don't ask, we expect that you will make that mountain of sin move, because you have said you will. So Father, by faith we push, and by faith we know that you will remove it, and that we will be the victor, because all things are possible through Christ who strengthens us.
Amen.
So we come before you now with this commitment. And Father, I ask that you will send angels that excel in strength to watch over each and every one of us, because the devil does not like this commitment. He doesn't want us to overcome. And he is going to double his attempts on each and every one of us. So Father, send your angels to push him back and to strengthen us. and give us that overcoming life of Christ. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.